Financial Survival Network, helping you to survive and thrive in the new economy.
This is the Financial Survival Network.
Financial Survival Network is presented to you by Regal Assets. Buy and sell physical gold and silver through your existing retirement plan 100% tax-free with Regal Assets. If you want to include physical gold or silver in your existing IRA or old 401k, request your free investment kit, which was recently featured in the Forbes and Smart Money Wall Street Journal magazines. Call toll-free 855-678-6620, 855-678-6620, or visit regalassets.com.
This is Kerry Lutz. You're listening to the Financial Survival Network. With me now, Mark Faber, editor and publisher of the Gloom, Boom, and Doom Report, to update us on the latest boom and gloom and doom going on in the world today. Dr. Faber, welcome. How are you today?
Well, I'm very well, and I hope you're fine. You can call me Mark.
Okay, Mark. I just was brought up that when people had titles ahead of their name, you always used it, but I'm old-fashioned. What can I tell you?
Very kind of you.
So you're an economist. You've got specific beliefs about the role of government, monetary policy. Can you just share with us what, in summary, your beliefs are?
Well, it is correct. I'm an economist, but I think I look at the world from a common man's point of view, and I analyze economic trends by essentially looking at reality and not textbooks from glass palaces at the Federal Reserve. And the world is never flat, as was the title of a book, but we have huge differences in economic developments in different parts of the world. We have some rising countries and some aging countries. I wouldn't go as far as to say that some countries experience an absolute decline, but this is the pattern of history, that countries have risen to wealth, and then they have disintegrated and become poor again. And I think that will continue to be the case. And for sure, not specifically the US, but the entire Western world is in a relative decline compared to nations that have young populations, growing populations, and plenty of energy and drive. In the West, we are an aging society that has become accustomed to wealth. We have grown in the last 30 years principally because of a rapid expansion of credit, consumer debt, mortgage debt, and that has allowed people to live way beyond their expectations and beyond their means. And so there will be a payback time real incomes per capita in the Western world will essentially be flat or, in my view, decline, as has been the case in the last 10 years.
So that's the trend. We see it kind of in our everyday life. We see the West really, like you say, in a prolonged state of decline, and it's been propped up over the past generation and a half by credit, by fake money printing by the Federal Reserve, right? Is there hope for the West that they can dig themselves out of, we can dig ourselves out of this morass, or is it game over and it becomes a world dominated by the Eastern powers?
Well, I'm very sorry to say I'm rather negative about the West's ability to dig itself out of the hole, principally because of the West's embedded arrogance and belief that they are superior in knowledge, innovation, skills, compared to other region of the world. And also, if I look at the crisis of 2008, It happened because of too much leverage and over indebtedness. In other words, credit had grown for the last 30 years way above nominal GDP growth. So the debt to GDP in the US did rise from 140% in 1980 to currently 379%. But that excludes the unfunded liabilities, Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid. If we added that to the official government debt, it would be something like 800% debt to GDP. And the crisis happens, and what is the reaction of the government and its agents at the Treasury and the Federal Reserve? Is to increase credit once again, but this time not in the private sector, but in the government sector. So instead of analyzing the crisis and addressing the problem of excessive debt, you give the patient who is deeply sick more drugs and that have made him sick. And so the debt level actually continues to increase. And I think it's going to end in a complete disaster. Complete disaster.
It's kind of like the punter at the casino, the gambler at the casino. He's $1 million, right? He's $1 million in debt. And rather than barring him from the casino, they up his line of credit to $5 million, hoping that he's somehow miraculously going to make it back. And we know that has to end in disaster. But
well, in China, they can make it back because they just steal it from the government.
But in the U.S., the government steals it from the people, right?
Yeah, they steal from everybody.
And so there's going to be this collapse. There's going to be this disaster. And you said real estate in already depressed markets like Phoenix, like Florida, might be a good place to go because, hey, you can get these dirt cheap government loans that anybody can qualify for. Anybody?
Well, I would buy it for cash.
You'd buy for cash?
You understand? My view is this. I think investors over the last 30 years, certainly since the low of the stock market in August 1982, when the Dow Jones was at 800, have become accustomed that asset prices, whether it's real estate or equities or bonds, always go up. And I think we're in a period which will end, and I don't know when it will happen, whether it happens tomorrow or in 5 years or 10 years, but at some stage there will be a huge wealth destruction. Now, as an investor, of course, I have also long positions in equities, not so much, actually hardly in the US, but I have equities here in Asia, I have real estate in Asia, and I have some cash and bonds, and of course a large position in gold. But basically, I believe that we have to start to think what will protect us the best from a complete wealth destruction. In other words, if the credit bubble really bursts and everything collapses, well, what is relatively safe? So I look at, say, I was in Atlanta and I was in Phoenix. I look at homes. They're selling, say, 30-40% below construction cost. Yes, they can still go down in value, and maybe they will. But all I'm saying is, in a complete collapse, they'll still have some value because people will have to live somewhere, and they won't be all empty. Whereas equities and bonds, who knows, maybe a lot of bonds will default or they will pay you back in money that is worthless. That is the real threat, say, in the United States. That the U.S. will always be able to print money. And so if you buy a treasury, for sure you'll get the money back. The question is, what will the value of that money be? Because as you may know, Janet Yellen, another genius, genius that is at the Federal Reserve, Vice Chairman now. She said, if it were possible to take interest rates into negative territory, I would be voting for that. Well, interest rates are negative, inflation adjusted significantly.
Terms.
Your inflation is, I bet you, between 5 and 10% per annum.
Oh, I think it's higher than that, and there's debates, because if you just use the Thanksgiving meal as the inflation indicator, 13% the past 2 years, it went up each year. And, you know, our inflation numbers are purely fraudulent because they exclude energy and they exclude food, the two things that we need to sustain modern life. We can't live without. So, yes.
I'm glad you're saying or spelling out the word fraudulent. The statistics that are published by the U.S. government and by other governments as well, I may add, are completely fraudulent. They misguide the public entirely.
Yeah, totally. And, you know, if we're talking about a collapse, the one thing I tell people about housing is go to markets where you can own cheaper than you can rent before taxes. So if you get that tax benefit, hey, that's icing on the cake. And there are a number of markets now where you can actually own your home. Of course, your partner's with the bank unless you pay cash, but you can own cheaper than you can rent, and then it becomes a really good investment. And
yeah, sure.
What about Joe Sixpack, our elusive Joe Sixpack in the U.S., who's becoming Joe Tupac because he can't afford a six-pack? He's got maybe $10,000 in his IRA to $20,000. Buy gold, buy silver. What should Joe Tupac be doing?
Well, I want to tell you something, you know, because I'm just writing about this subject. Recently, a report was published. It's called the World Happiness Survey. And essentially talks about the happiness of people, and that you shouldn't pay attention only to GDP growth, but also to other factors that make people happy. And I think one of the big factors in the happiness of people is if your expectations are exceeded, I think you will live a life that is relatively happy, because every year you do relatively better. It's like your site or your program. Mm-hmm. You have rising subscribers, so you feel happy about it. And if one day the subscribers go down and the listeners and the audience diminishes, you will feel less happy. And I truly feel sorry for a lot of nice and really hard-working, working-class people who are workers or lower-middle-class people that have a simple job but are decent people. Their standards of living has been going down. Everything that they earn in addition, and in many cases their wages have actually gone down, but where the wages have still gone up a little bit, it's been eaten up by inflation and by increased direct and indirect and hidden taxes.
Right, like inflation.
And you know, I don't say that because I have a grudge. I'm one of these idiotic financial people that have actually benefited from the financial bubble. I'm a profiteer of the system. And I say this with some remorse, because it's not right that I've done so well, largely, and I have to say that and admit that, at the expense of ordinary people.
Well, and due to the stupidity of governments, because there are no free markets, so that enables you
it's all manipulated. Yep. And Mr. Bernanke is a criminal. You know, a lot of people are decent fellows. They have their money on deposits. Now they get precisely zero interest rates.
Yeah. Yeah. So I was going to ask you, like, the key to a happy life, because it's been said that money can't buy happiness, but it'll do till the real thing comes along. And obviously you've had a happy, fulfilling life. And is the key to that to diminish?
And I also had a lot of shit in my life.
So how do we get to this happiness? Is it where you live? Okay, you're in a great place.
Tell you something. I mean, different people have different views, but I was recently invited to an event for his platinum members by Tony Robbins.
Uh-huh.
And I like him. He's a great motivational speaker. And I'm sure he's helped a lot of people in his life. And the people that were there had a great time and enjoyed everything. And and one thing he said, and the theme of this event was really, if you want to be have a life satisfaction and some degree of happiness, it helps if you're financially independent. You know, that you don't have to wait every month for your salary check to pay your credit card debts and so forth. And I think there is one way to achieve this is not to live beyond your means. I mean, if you only have a salary of $3,000 a month, then you should live maybe like someone who has only a salary of $2,000 and save $1,000 a month. I mean, I don't have cars. Before I got married, I had two Porsches. Now my wife has a Porsche and I have no car. But it doesn't matter. I like motorcycles, so it's fine with me. But you can live modestly. And I know lots of people who are very happy without being rich.
Mm-hmm. So being rich is, in a lot of respects, overrated. And finally, assuming this economic collapse comes to pass, or it's going to, where do you think, for a Westerner, the best place to seek refuge, the best country to go to? Is it in South America, Costa Rica, Uruguay? Is it in Asia or Australia? Where would a Westerner go if this collapse comes about and they manage to get out before?
How old are you?
I am 54, going to be 55.
And are you single or married?
I'm married and unfortunately have children in the country. Escape, fleeing the country isn't really an option for me much as I'd like to.
But you understand, your question is very personal. Our friends in Switzerland, they go every year on their holidays to Brazil because they love Brazil. Others, they go to Santo Domingo. And most of them who are single and young and enjoy partying and life, they go to Thailand.
Yeah.
So it depends a little bit where, what you enjoy and the stage of your life. Like if I was 25, when I went to Hong Kong, I was 26 in 1973. And I would do the same. I would go probably today to either Hong Kong, Singapore, Vietnam, Cambodia, Myanmar, China, or maybe India, although I'm not that attracted to the Indian culture per se. And if I'm at my age, I like to live in Chiang Mai because I travel a lot. So when I'm at home, I enjoy the peace here. I still have nightlife here, and it's a nice city. The climate is ideal. It's hot during the day, which I like, and cool at night, and not so humid. And now we have Thai New Year, Songkran, which is characterized by huge water battles on the street. I mean, this is like carnival in Rio. Everybody throws water at each other. You can't walk out of your house without being totally soaked.
That sounds like fun.
Yes, you should come once.
I've been to Thailand 15 years ago in Bangkok. I loved it, and you know, but family. So anyway, Dr. Faber, is there any final advice you have for people as far as the doom when the boom busts? You know, the best thing to be doing?
Well, there's one more point I want to make. And people always think of earning money and of wealth. There's also in knowledge a lot of wealth. And I believe the people that will survive the best is we are in a world that changes dramatically and very fast. Just to think of China. 10 years ago, it had, say, 10% of global nickel, copper, aluminum consumption, and today it's between 40 and 50% in just 10 years. We have huge changes. And I think that we have to educate ourselves every day. And instead of watching basketball, football, and baseball every day, I would think about how do I maintain my relative knowledge, because we have a lot of young people coming up and they have special skills that I, for instance, don't have. I have a computer. I know how to handle it to some extent, but I don't know how to fix it. And so we elderly people, we have to really work on ourselves and try to keep up with the incredible changes that are happening.
Oh, yeah. And there are so many things, and the internet opens up such a world of learning and business that people could never do before. I can Absolutely. Compete with an international media conglomerate from
Yes.
where I'm sitting here. I'm in Greenwich, Connecticut. Yes. I'm looking at the Long Island Sound, and you know Yes. the world is my oyster. I have listeners.
Yes,
people
we
are
also
listening.
Have plenty of porno sites.
Yeah, well, the city of Los Angeles is cracking down on that because you're not going to be able to have pornography filmed in the city of Los Angeles without protection, and the porno industry is threatening to move, probably going back to its roots in Thailand or in Sweden, where you have laissez-faire porn, and maybe there's something to it.
You know, there's another point about the economy in the Western world. When I look at when we grew up, you're 54, I'm 66, we were much freer. We had much more freedom.
Yes.
And today there's regulation about this, regulation about that. And that increases the cost of doing business. It wastes your time. And it creates an economy that is far less dynamic.
Yeah. And it winds up having less people employed because employees become such a burden that you're expanding your business, you want to outsource, and you can outsource to any place in the world now and get the best value, any job you can, and that's
yeah,
a story.
I agree with you. I yeah. agree.
So I have a guy in the Philippines who was doing a lot of programming for me, and he yep. could do it while I slept. I mean, whether he did it or not was another story, but you know, it's really an amazing thing that the world has become so much smaller. And the fact that I can sit here in Greenwich and interview you in Thailand, and you know, the world is a totally different place. And
yeah, it's remarkable.
What you say is that too many Americans, they're interested in American Idol, and they're interested in externalities rather than improving themselves, investing in their own human capital.
Yeah.
And it's never been easier to do it. That's the amazing thing.
Yeah,
you could
sure.
sit down today, and in 6 months you could have a degree from a good college in any subject that you want to learn about, and yet they're busy with American Idol. On that note, Dr. Faber, thank you so much for being on.
It's my pleasure. Thanks a lot.
And your site again for your report eludes my limited memory cells that are left.
Doomboomdoom.com.
Gloomboomdoom.com. And yeah. your nickname is Dr. Doom, but I don't see it that way.
Well, the original Dr. Doom is still a friend of mine, was Henry Kaufman in the 70s.
Oh, sure.
He was bearish about the bond market. And Al Wojnilower, who was at first Boston, he was called Dr. Death because he was even more negative than Henry Kaufman. And so I have to give to Henry Kaufman the credit for the original Dr. Doom.
Well, nowadays, if you look back, just like JFK was a conservative, Henry Kaufman was an optimist, if you compare him to people today, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yes, I agree. Okay.
All right.
Nice
thanks so much.
You
be well.
Bye-bye.
I'll talk to
Take
you again
care.
Soon.
Bye. Yes. Okay. Bye. All the best.
You too.